Where were you born and raised?
Okay, I was born in a small town, of Northbridge, Massachusetts, about 45 miles from Boston. January 8th, 1921.
Is that where you were raised?
Yes.
So it was this kind of a small town upbringing?
Well, 10,000 people, it's about four or five sections. Whitensville was the big part of the town, about probably 6,000 people. It was Northbridge Center, Rockdale, Linwood.
Was it a good place to be brought up? Was there a lot of things for kids to do?
Everyone was poor, but our town, the name Whitensville is formed by the Whiten LaSalle family. And Whiten, these were the rich people, the Whitens and LaSalles. They were a generous family. We had a gymnasium, and there were some ponds around. We had places to swim. We had woods to roam around in. I liked the outdoors.
It does. It sounds like an outdoor childhood.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And the summer was great. It was crazy. We could go out and pick grapes and get some fruit off some of the trees. And the farmers didn't mind too much.
Did you
get poison ivy? Oh. That was always a joy every summer. But kids' things, mostly.
Were you the kind of kid, did you like school?
No. No, I was kind of a slow type B, I'd say. In first grade, compared to the children today, going to preschool and whatever else, in first grade I learned my ABCs and my colors. Orange, red, blue. Today, coming back from my hike, lately coming back from my hike, the children are waiting to go on the school bus, and a fellow told me his daughter in the first grade is learning computers. And I thought, well, good for you. I learned ABC and red, orange, white, and blue. You know, so anyway, that was my... But school was good. Second grade, I remember Mrs. Cheney. First grade, we had a real nice, very strict, but good teacher. Miss Love was her name. Mm-hmm. And she was good. She was strict, but she was a good teacher. Miss Cheney, I didn't like her because one day we had to go from the first to the second grade. Something was going on. And no talking, okay, so John Washington. And two children behind me were talking. And so Miss Cheney saw me coming through the door. And she came over and she snapped me in the lips. And that hurt. I wanted to cry. And I didn't know why she hit me for talking. This is why she snapped my lips. And I hurt, but I didn't say anything. But she snapped me because these two were talking. So I remember her. Anyway, I was through school, I was a C student. I didn't study too hard.
You know, when you walk into a classroom full of kids like that, there's all the full spectrum of personalities, the mm-hmm. smart kid, the quiet kid, the mm-hmm. joker kid. Which kid were you in the classroom?
Well, I was the quiet kid. Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, did the Depression affect your family?
Well, Depression affected every family, except by the rich people that owned the... Whiten. I swear, I forgot the word. When you start to say something, what's the word I'm looking for? You know. I have... Okay, you don't know.
No.
Okay. The rich people owned this factory and employed around 3,000 people. They manufactured textile machinery, which was very well known throughout the South and throughout the world. They'd go South America and whatnot. Of course, that all went down the tubes, textiles, and so forth. But it was a good place to work. They didn't pay anything, but they provide a place to live, to mow the lawns and so forth. And Whitensville was a good little part of the town to live in. And luckily, no one had any money, we were poor, but we had enough to eat. We didn't starve.
Did you have some sense when Pearl Harbor happened that you would be, you were going to get called up or you were
no,
going to get drafted?
No, I wasn't old. Well, I was getting close to it. I wasn't worried about it. You don't worry about those things when you're 20 years old. Mm-hmm. My friends were getting called up. Oh, they had to sign up when they became 21.
Well, talk about then, how did you get into the Army Air Corps?
I enlisted. Right after Pearl Harbor, a whole bunch of us.
Why did you decide to enlist?
Because I wanted to.
Yeah, but why did you want to?
Well, because what Hitler had been doing for 4 years, it blowing up Poland, Germany, Russia, France, the whole rest of Europe. Britain was hanging on by his fingernails. People over there were getting killed left and right. They were the only nation left to keep the rest of Europe going down the tubes. We were helping all we could, but not... not legally, you know.
What? Why did you choose the Army Air Corps?
They didn't want to march in the mud. I wanted to fly. Never been in an airplane, but I wanted to. Why the guys from Iowa joined the Navy? I never figured that out. That's why I wanted to fly.
Well, take us through the training then. I mean, you know, they take a kid and you're into the Army Air Corps.
Okay, went to training, went up to Fort Devens, Mass, January, cold. If you ask stuff, first day there, Saturday, some sergeant went through the lights on about 4 or 5 in the morning, so I jumped up, being a good soldier, and the spring of the cart ripped my overcoat, big rip in the overcoat, I remember that. Okay, we went to Chow. SOS, I guess it was, or something. And we're coming back, and it was some guy, I don't know if he had any stripes or not, but he was looking for people for details. So I remember we all started to run and hide. I got on the detail anyway. The first thing I think I was mopping floors in some little barracks or a lieutenant or something, and a lot of cleaning the latrines and stuff and running around. Oh, I know. Even before that, we signed up and took us a train near Boston. They had about 5,000 guys in a great big warehouse. And there's some guys calling names. Gee, after about 20 minutes, you get down to the M's. You get me, I'm a Jilly. Nobody answered. He called about 5 times. And a buddy of mine said, do you think he means you? Here. Yes, it's blank, blank. Well, I called your name, answer up. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Magill. That was Magilly. Okay. So that's a lot. But I always thought that was kind of funny. Where the hell was it? What was it like? Okay, so anyway, we're running around. After a few weeks of mopping floors and any other clean latrines, they're going to send 700 Yankees down to, where do you want to go, Biloxi, Mississippi, or some other place? Anyway, it was great. They sent us to Shreveport, Louisiana, and a nice permanent type Air Force base. And see, now it's gone. And I was there for quite a long time. Anyway, I took the aviation cadet exam, at which time you had to have at least 2 years of college to qualify. The war broke out. They said, well, if you can pass the written exam and physical, we'll let you in. What can I lose? I want to go. So I took the written exam. You had to get 150 questions. You had to get 90 or better. So I took it. I went to high school, took the easy business course, because I knew you didn't go to college unless your folks were rich or you were smart. You know, type A stipend, and you get a scholarship. Well, so I was neither one, so I knew I wasn't going there, so I took the easy course. And I got 91. It really surprised me. So then we waited about 4 months because, of course, the war's on, everybody's joining up in this, drafting me. And it was about 30 or 40 of us waiting to get called to go classification for aviation cadet. Okay. Finally, in the meantime, we're building, they don't know what to do with us. We didn't have to pull guard duty or march or drill or the minor stuff. So they had us build a rifle range out of this Louisiana clay. There was a little creek, a river, small river. And we took this muck in wheelbarrows, one guy in the front with the rope and the other guy on the handles, and filled it up as we gradually built up, up, up. We built the rifle range so they could fire into the bank. Okay, that was good exercise. But I don't know if you noticed my arm or not. This is why I was getting into basketball. I started playing semi-pro ball after high school, and the semi-pro league wasn't exactly easy. And at that time, I wasn't quite 6 foot tall, but I could jump up and touch the rim. I couldn't dunk it like the big boys, but I had pretty good vertical leap. So on this one particular time at a fast break, I was up the man, I was just going to lay it in nice and easy. This guy, instead of going up and block it, he threw a block right across my knees. And they said I did a somersault and came down and hit the floor, both bones, compound fracture, 6 months in a cast, and a nice bow. And to this day, I can't rotate it like this. If you whack it head on, or if somebody, like we were wrestling, you twisted it, man, I'm on my knees. I said, you live with it. But anyway, that was the basketball story. So I get in the aviation cadets. I passed it, get on the train, come out to Santa Ana. Flight surgeon there looked at it, and he called a colonel over. Colonel looked at it, and he took my arm here and here, and he's going like this. And he said, what the hell are you doing in the service, son? I said, I want to fly, sir. He put me on limited service, which means you'll never go overseas. I didn't know that. So anyway, back through, training some more, and then went to aviation mechanics school. This is about a year later, I took the cadet exam again. Well, by now I got 135 in the test, and a flight surgeon shaking his head again. And he had me squeeze his hand and test him. He says, if you can stand on your hands, I'll pass you. Because now they've been shooting down 60 bombers on one mission at a time, Regensburg, Frankfurt, bit. I said, I never stood in my hands in my life. He says, you take off your shoes, go stand against that wall, face it, and let your feet hit up on the wall. Okay. This guy's crazy. So anyway, I did it. You know, I surprised him and I surprised myself more. And that's how I got into aviation cadets. They made a test so easy, if you were in the fifth grade, I think you could have passed it. So that got me started flying. I got in, went to Bombardier School, got commissioned, met the crew. My religious story. Went to train, got out of Bombardier, trained with the crew, Ben Gatch, and the crew, for about 4 months. Time to go overseas. Okay, we're going overseas. All you bombers are going to stay back. They don't need you over there. You stay back, you're going to train with new crews. Because we all complained in a nice way. And I guess we took about a 10-day lead and then came back and met the new crew that we're with now, who trained with them, of course, went overseas. So I got over there and started asking around. I said, hey, anybody here know Ben Gatch? And one fellow says, oh, yeah, we knew Ben Gatch. He said, they got shot up on the first mission over Germany and went down in the channel and never found them on the first mission.
And that was the crew you trained with?
That was the crew I trained with. Well, so this guy that broke my arm, I didn't like at all. I was really didn't like him. I hate to use the word hate, but I think I hated him. Because I had a lot of misery with that arm. It's never been right. But he probably saved my life. Because had I gone through cadets the first time, I'd have been through training in time for about the time to get ready for the first cruise that went over and had about a 25% chance of getting through there's 25 missions and coming home. So maybe he saved my life. I don't know. Maybe God knows. He says, I need you for something. I don't know what you're good for, but you're not going over with Ben Gatch, you're going to stay here and we'll go back later. So I don't know. But I keep praying, and he talks to me once in a while and gives me, get over there, you know. So.
Well, where did it go from there? You'd just been held, all you bombardiers had been held back. What happened then?
Well, we just trained with the new crew, and then we went overseas. Yeah.
And did you fly over, or did you take a ship?
No, we flew over. We took it. We trained, and then we went over. We went to Hunter Field, Georgia. Got a new airplane. We went up to Manchester, New Hampshire. Yeah, a few days, then to Gander, and stayed there for a week or two while I got the weather was supposed to be good. And finally said, okay, you guys go. So we took off about dark and went across and got about almost halfway across, and the weather closed in like this. And next thing we know, we're in the middle of a blizzard, and it packed the pitot tube, so the airspeed meter started going like this. And the pilot thought we were about to ice up on the wings or something, and we're stalling out. So he put the nose down, brought the power up. There's a tail side vibrating. I don't know, we're probably going 300 miles an hour or something, to realize that, hey, that finally the airspeed is, you know, blocked up. So anyway, he brought it back up, and power settings to normal, altitude normal. Yeah, 20 minutes later, well, we got out of the storm, and then this SB started coming back up again. So we're not even in combat, and man, we already had our first gear. But that was interesting, I thought.
Are you heading for Iceland?
No, we're going to Scotland. Mm-hmm. We landed in Scotland. We got into a pool, waited a while, and then finally got shipped to the 390th. That's how we finally arrived, and then trained for about, seemed like a month, for whatever. We didn't get into combat until March. And, you know, they had 19 missions. Well, three were the Chowhound. I think Sam was next, had four. They were short of navigators. So in Bombardier training, in the last few weeks, they give you what they call DI navigation, where it's a visual, you can see the ground. There's no celestial training. And so you know a little bit about it. But, of course, in these bombing missions, you're at 25, 27,000 feet. You're in formation on somebody's wing like this all the time. And the compasses are going like this. Anyway, they took about four or five bombardiers, I guess, from our group and other groups, and gave us a few, about a week of ground school. I don't know, probably maybe 20 hours, supposedly, of training. And they said, okay, you're navigators, you're going to fly as navigators. But it was in a formation. Of course, we were always over on the outside someplace, but we were always on somebody's wing after we found. The only thing, the first mission we took off in the fog, we had to fly out to the coast to a bunch of signaling, fly out over to France. We broke out of the weather, I guess we were about 18,000 feet over France, so we finally broke out. And the pilot says, I don't see anybody. You know, we're supposed to form up. He said, I don't see anybody. But we finally found somebody. But that was kind of a hairy thing. Cause, then they had G-block, is what they call a little navigational aid. They had about five of them because they had very short range. And as you went in over Germany, you're supposed to change this block to get the next distance. And I figured, If I'm over Germany and I get all shot up in here with this crew, do you think I'm going to take this box out and unplug it and then take this other box and plug that box in and here I'm going down in flames or whatever terrible? So I said, the heck with that. I'll leave this original box in that tells me I'm over the English. I think I can find the English Channel. If we got enough power to get that far back, I'm going to leave this one here. And then I can find the base, you know. Because I didn't care. When I got back, the squadron navigator called me in, you know, my log. He said, are you lost? He says, no, I knew where I was all the time. You did. And I didn't have any entries in there, you know, big blank space. I said, yeah. I said, I was right there. This plane was here, and we were right there. And we stayed all the way back. I said, I was never lost. You know, you hear a smile. Because, hell, we weren't navigators, you know. But we just filled in a slot. But that was the last three, actually. I flew with some other crew. It was a made-up crew, the pilot from this here. And all the other crewmen were for different guys that had, they needed some more missions to get the rest of the tour in, you know. That was funny.
Were there other missions that, you're not going to remember all 18 missions, but were there missions that stand out in your mind?
Oh, they're very interesting, yes.
Tell
the first one. Yeah. Is that a good, when you get back, say, was that an easy mission? Was that a hard mission? You know, was that? You don't know the first mission. Well, it was, to the veterans, it wasn't bad to them, but it was not an easy mission. It was a lot of flak. So by then was the end of the war, and the Germans had a lot of the flak was they could it was mobile, you know, it was on trains, and as they had to withdraw into Germany, they could withdraw all this flak. So by the time we got the end of the war, man, they were loaded with flak all over the place. So that was one of the big that, and then they had the fighters. Most of the Allies had shot down all the best pilots, and most of all the airplanes would bomb almost the oil and ball bearings and everything else. But they had the jet fighters that were, you know, super fast.
Did you ever see a jet fighter?
Yeah, oh yeah, we saw a couple of them.
What did they look like?
Well, it was just a normal size fighter, a twin. It had two engines slung underneath. Nothing outstanding about it. That was probably the feature, but they were so fast. On two occasions, we had an 18-year-old waist gunner and an 18-year-old tail gunner. Well, both times they came in on the tail, and our tail gunner saw them. He saw first, he sees the flashes, they fired at us. And when he saw them fire, he fired back. And as soon as he did, the German peeled off, and there was one other plane on the outside of us, and he shot down the guy beside us. The second time that happened, the same routine, and he shot down, put them on fire. They all got out. They all bailed out. But the irony of it is, that plane was carrying leaflets. Didn't even have bombs. It was the end of the war, and they told them to people that it's over, just go lay down and you'll get food and you'll get this and that, and you know, it was leaflets. But it was kind of ironic that they seen this out there. But yeah, that's the only fighters we saw, with a couple of the ME-262s. Yeah.
Was there anybody ever injured on your crew?
No. Mm. No. No. Thank God.
Due to flak, was there ever engine damage or anything like that?
No. We got some pretty good size holes in the plane. You hear it rattling around in the bomb base, but no one was ever injured. We landed one time, and Joe, the navigator, he sat behind us up in the nose, and Joe sat sideways to me. We got out, and we started walking around outside the airplane. Right beside where Joe was sitting is a hole about this big. We didn't realize that it was, you know, it's that big a hole, but it kind of surprised everybody, especially Joe. Joe is it's too bad he's not. He just died a year ago. He was captain of the Virginia Tech football team. He had the great big lovable Southern gentleman. But oh God, he's something else.
Were there other missions, for whatever reason, maybe stand out in your mind?
No. You know, the oil refineries, they were always heavily attended. Well, they are all the, you know, other than the food missions were outstanding in a different manner. They meant.
Well, tell us about that was Operation Chowhound. Mm-hmm. Tell us about the food missions. What was that like?
Just one, but it was like, I guess it was a racetrack. and there were thousands of people, and they were on the roof. The city we went to Amsterdam, Rotterdam, and Leiden. Those were the cities that were near, but the names that we went to, if I had, was some cities that, Dutch names that don't, but anyway, those are the major cities that were near. But on the roofs of the cities, the roofs of the buildings were lined. They were starving 1,000 people a day, we were told. And it's true, I guess. Because the Germans had raped the land, taken everything they had, and they weren't satisfied. They blew up the dikes and flooded the fields with seawater so they couldn't plant and grow stuff to eat. They said they were eating tulip bulbs. You know.
How many of those did you go on?
I went on three.
Three?
Yeah.
And so they would like load food into?
Yeah. The bomb bags had platform, instead of the bomb, well, the racks were still there, but they had plywood platforms on the bottom, and they put flour and sugar and a lot of 10-in-1 rations, and they just load them on the platform, just sitting there. Okay, we'd go over, and we had to take all of the barrels out of the 50 caliber guns, and we had to fly, I think it was 500 feet, and 135 indicators or something. And the flak towers were not to shoot at us. And they didn't.
Because the war is still going on, right?
Well, the agreement was the Germans, they had to get permission to do this. Well, they got permission, this was part of the agreement, that they wouldn't shoot at us and we wouldn't shoot at them. Because the Germans figured if they dropped this food, we're going to get some of it. Because they weren't as hungry as the Dutch, but they were pretty hungry themselves. So they gave us permission. This was probably, let's say, VE was 8 days. This was over May 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right there. Okay, so anyway, we're supposed to come in low and slow. Anyway, we come in and we get down to 400 feet, 300 feet, maybe 130, as slow as you could go. Then come in and there'd be, a big white cross or something we were supposed to draw up. And I think Joe the Navigator, a little road map or something. We didn't have maps. And we come in and looked and figured that, well, there's a grandstand, and Joe said, there it is up there. Okay, there it is. And the bombardiers, you had the bomb sight and all this stuff, but you also had what they call a salvo handle. All you had to do was just push that handle forward, and that would open up, the plywood doors would swing open, and all this food would drop out. And that's how they dropped it, just in one big mass. So you had all these airplanes flying over, and they come down and drop, and all this food is going flying all over the place. But what breaks me up is all these people, you know. Plus, as you come in off the Zuider Zee and you swung over Holland, miles of beautiful tulips, every color of the rainbow, canals and windmills, you know. And then this one mission, the first mission, we dropped the food, and then so we kind of climb up a little. We left to fly low. We've been used to 25,000 feet and freezing and everything else. So we come back and pull up and start flying across Holland, heading back home. And there's one man out there all alone, you know, by himself. So we get back. Tell the radio operator, he's back there. He's right behind the bomb bays. The pilots are here, the bomb bays are here, and then the radio operator's in his little place by himself, and he has the door. He opens right over the bomb bay. So I said, the next time we'll take some of those 10-1 racks and keep about 6 of those boxes. And as we see these people alone out there, we'll throw it out through the bomb bay. So that's what we did this next mission. We see somebody alone, and as the bombardier saw, I was sitting up there in front, and said, "Get ready, Teddy." And I said, "Get ready, ready, go." And he threw a box out. And one I threw out, it landed in a canal, and the tail gunner says, "Hey, you missed it, it went in the water." No, I guess, I don't know, maybe a sand says, "You went in the water," and the tail gunner says, "Ah, don't worry about it, the guy in a rowboat, he's going like crazy yet." It was a very heart-wrenching
thing. It had to be satisfying, that kind of thing.
Well, that's what I mean. To go from dropping bombs on people and dropping food. Yeah. I don't know.
When you flew your 18th mission, your last mission, did you know that was your last mission when you flew it?
Well, the war was over.
Well, but I know you flew.
V-Day, bang, bang. The Tannoy system said there will be no more shooting of the very pistol. You had a signal pistol to fire red if it's wounded on board and so forth, green. And everybody was shooting those things. So they announced, you know, real loud, there will be no more firing of very pistols. Wham! Every gun in the camp went off.
And so, as you've described, the war in Europe was over. Mm-hmm. How long did you stay there then before you went home?
May 8th was declared VE Day. I guess we came back to the States in July. So, June, July, I was back in the States.
Did you fly back or take a ship back?
Flew back, yeah.
Was there any superstition about flying back? You'd survived all those missions and then... You know, no, you just wanted to get home?
The other navigator had a girlfriend, Margaret. He was always singing, coming back from the mission. "I'm coming home, Miss Margaret." Joe is this great big rugged guy, and he had the highest pitched squeaky voice. Sam, the next guy you interview, ask him to imitate Joe Hoffman. He can do it. He's got it to a T. But he'd always say, "I'm coming home, Miss Margaret." But that was the feeling he had. No, you're coming home. Flying was, why'd you join the Air Force? Because you love to fly, but you know, you were scared to death going up. You had your fingers crossed. I think we all prayed.
How do you handle that kind of stress at such a young age?
Well, you got something to do. I guess it's the training, the way you were brought up, time your kids, and if you played sports, it's like going the first time you're going into the game, like you're a 16-year-old captain, and you don't have much confidence. So it's the first time you're going to go fly your first mission. You don't know what's ahead of you. But somehow you just have to pull up your bootstraps, and you've got a job to do. You're going to do the best you can. Mm-hmm. And what happened? You don't worry about what you don't. You care, but you don't worry about what's going to happen. You just got to think, what's my job, and I'm going to do it. You can't worry about what's going to happen.
Well, you got back to the States. The war in Japan's still going on.
Yeah.
What's your situation? I mean, are you? You know, a lot of guys were training on B-29s and or whatever. Did you get leave? I mean, what happened when you got back?
Well, no. When we got back, everybody got to leave. I think, I don't know, 15 days or something, everyone on leave. Then we went back to Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and went through and said, "You want to stay in and get out?" I said, "I want to get out." I had never heard or seen a briefing or anything about the GI Bill. This is, I made a lot of mistakes, but this is right up there with number one. This is probably number two. And so I messed around and I went to work for my father and another man had a small printing business. So I went to work there. And some salesman then came in and he was a pretty good job in the Navy. He had a pretty high ranking job in the Navy and he mentioned something about the GI Bill. And I said, "Oh, what's that?" And anyway, he explained a bunch of things and then he says, "Well, you can," he mentioned about college. Well, by then, the other thing, VE Day was May 8th. My daughter was born May 7th. Sam's daughter coming in, she was born about 2 weeks later. Anyway, he came in, that's when I first heard about the GI Bill. And I thought, "Oh, I'm married, I have a child, I can't go to college." I was pretty much a negative thinker for myself, I guess. I had trouble studying or learning. I'm not a quick learner. Mm. It's later on, 10 years later, the Mass Guard got fighter interceptors, and so I had a chance to get back into flying and join the Guard. Go sit in the back seat of fighter interceptors as a radar observer officer. And so I wanted to go to RO school in Waco, and he says, "Well, you can't go there unless you go to navigator school." I said, "Okay, I'll go to navigator school." He says, "We'll go to Mesa, 9 months, get a navigator rating." "Okay, fine." So I went there, got my RO in Waco, and came back and flew for short time. Things didn't go too good. Fighter pilots are a funny bunch. They like their airplane, but they don't want anybody all looking over their shoulder. They like to be alone. And they're kind of a funny crowd. Anyway, I ended up out in Portland, Oregon, had the same deal, National Guard. So anyway, I went out and transferred in Oregon Guard, flew with them for about 9 years. But they went from the two-seater fighters to single-seat fighter 102s, but they had a reserve outfit flying the old 119 boxcars. So they are, "Yeah, we need navigators." So about three or four of us. Oregon didn't say you had these sent guys to RO school. But fortunately, Massachusetts says, "No, you can't unless you get a nav rating." So I had the nav rating. Never had flown as a navigator. But anyway, I had the rating, so I went there and they kind of trained me in the boxcar. And after about 2 years, they closed that outfit. They sent that outfit up to McCord. Now you can train as the C-141 Farrington Starlifter jet with a high T-tail. I think they just now got rid of them and went to the C-9. But for 5 years, it took me about 3 years to get checked out into the modern age radars and all this stuff. But they welcomed me, the active duty people welcomed me to train the young navigators as a student. I mean, I say I'm a slow learner. Man, it was so different going into the jet airplane, you know, because the back seat of a fighter airplane, you work the radios somewhat, but mostly it's on that radar setting. There's a plane dot over here, and you get up on that dot, and you work, and it's all over. next intercept, you know, it's quit like that. So anyway, it took me a long time to get checked out. Finally, I did. So then for 5 years, I was flying back and forth to NAM, mostly North Pack up through Alaska, down the chain, and down into the Philippines, zipping back and forth to NAM, or Korea and back. And I did get one good trip down to Australia and New Zealand, through Pango Pango, and another 15-day trip. What the hell was that? Someday. I had 25 days. Well, I just went over to Thailand. We took the 141, the 141 to Thailand and just supplied troops in around Thailand area.
Hmm. Back and forth. How long were you in the service then?
Well, all told, I had 24 good years as a reserve. If you earn 60 points a year, that's a good year for you. If you earn 59, that doesn't count. So anyway, I retired in 1972, and I had to wait 9 years until I was 60 years old before I could get any retirement pay.